Tervetuloa. And Kristin, who's our Finnish representative. Kristin, is that correct?
Yes.
Thank goodness. I'm glad you're here. We're going to do Finland. We're going to open face sandwiches, which my fabulous volunteers have made. They are gorgeous, which is simply rye crisp sort of bread or bread topped with cottage cheese and veggies. We're going to have fish stew. Mm. It will be white potatoes with white onions and milk and white fish. Oh. And I'll demonstrate a little bit of the stew. Kristin, our Finnish person, heritage, made the pulla bread. And then we have lingonberry jam and rye cookies with caraway. And can you imagine, rye cookies with caraway are delicious. Oh my gosh, they are so good. You will love to have those recipes. This week, Ann and I drove to Elkhart Lake to visit Pirka, who runs the Nordic Accents gift shop in Elkhart Lake for 30 years. And she's from Finland. And she said to us, she likes to go back to Finland to visit her family, but she's not going to go this year. She's afraid of the Russians. Yeah, because then, of course, there's the Winter War for Finland, 1939. Russia did to Finland exactly what they're doing to the Ukraine. All right, we have geography books, we have cookbooks. Kristin Plusser from the Art Center has a Finnish background, so I ask her all the Finnish words, and she knows a couple.
I know a very few Finnish words. My mom's side of the family is Finnish-American, and my grandparents are first-generation Finnish-Americans and grew up speaking Finnish in the home. My mom did not, of course. She could understand a little bit, yeah, but she wasn't encouraged to speak Finnish. It was, you know, English.
Being American. Yep.
But when I did travel to Finland when I was in my 20s because I wanted to be back in, you know, the old country. and I could say, en puhutko suomea, en puhue suomea, which means I don't speak Finnish. And puhutko englantia, which means do you speak English? But because I look pretty Finnish, a lot of people would not, they kind of, they didn't really think that I was being honest, maybe. I don't know.
They really?
I got a lot of really weird looks, like, oh, you don't speak Finnish? So I was in Finland for about a month, but my mom's is a Lutvala, and from northern Minnesota, so she comes from a small Minnesota Finnish-American community. It's a little town called Tamarack. It's just west of Duluth, a couple of hours.
Oh, north.
In sort of like a wetland with tamarack forest. So it's beautiful up there. It's a beautiful area. But most of the people in Tamarack, there's about 65 people that live there now, are Finnish, and most of them are probably related to each other. Yep. They have a tiny little Lutheran church with no running water. You have to use the outhouse when you're there. And they have someone who comes through about once a month, you know, and I went once with my parents and I was like, oh, I'm related to like 75% of the people here. So it's a very tight, you know, kind of closed community. But when we were growing up, when Marilyn and I were talking about food for today, the things I remember mom cooking at home, which were, you know, from her background, were moika, which is Finnish stew. So that's why we came up with the kala moika, is fish stew. My brother and I probably didn't like fish in soup very much because kids don't. But so we had a lot of venison moika.
Reindeer?
Deer meat. Yeah, right. We never had reindeer. But moika is actually a Finnish-American word. So if you went to Finland and you were going to order fish stew, it's a different word for it. Moika is something distinctly Finnish-American and not related to Finnish from Finland. So we grew up with moika and pulla bread, visiting, it's the Scandinavian cardamom bread, and so it's got a different name in each Scandinavian country. It's pretty much the same thing everywhere, but at least in mom's family, on Sundays and other times of the week, you go visiting, right? So like Sunday afternoons. I imagine everyone's trying to visit everyone else, so no one's home.
And sometimes, right, they have little notepads outside. They do, on the door frame, yep.
But it would be coffee with Pulla. So there's a Pulla making day of the week where, you know, my grandmother would make bread, and then when you visit, you get coffee, and you always get bakery to go with it. There's just like, and you have coffee about 6 times a day. So you have coffee with breakfast, you have coffee in between breakfast and lunch, you have coffee at lunch, you have coffee in between lunch and supper, you have coffee at supper, and then you have coffee before you go to bed. So there's like 6 times a day, like it is a coffee culture.
Now, Kristin, I bought finished coffee at the gift shop in Elkhart Lake, and we have it today, and it is very gentle, mild coffee.
Yeah, I used to... My mom grew up on weak finished coffee, and I tease her about it because when I make coffee at home for her, if she's visiting, she always has to add hot water to it because mine is just too. But they drink coffee all day long.
Sure.
You know. And my grandparents always had a pot on the stove. And I'd say, probably with the stew, my grandpa grew up in a family of 13 children.
Wow.
And his father was from Finland, and they lived rural Minnesota. Quite poor, and so they would eat whatever they could hunt or fish or trap or grow in the garden. So it was, you know, whatever would go in the stew.
Yes.
With the potatoes and the onions.
Right.
Could you share with us the story on December the 13th with the teenagers serving the grandparents and so on? The candle lit, that sweet.
I didn't grow up with that tradition.
No.
Mm-mm. No.
I had read about that.
Yeah, it may be something that's done, but yeah, it's not a tradition that I grew up with.
Yeah, Santa.
Oh, yeah, that's a Swedish thing, I think. But
yes.
They
okay.
You
did
that
not.
In Finland. No.
And Finnish is not like Swedish or Norwegian. Finnish is a completely different language related to the Hungarian language.
Okay.
Would you turn off the stove?
Pardon?
Turn off the stove. Thanks.
Yeah. That I've always wanted to study Finnish language, but I have also heard that it's difficult and it isn't related to Swedish or Norwegian in its roots. So, I wore my sisu pin. I don't know if anyone else in this room is familiar with the sisu. I see sort of.
I've heard the word before.
Shaking a little nod. Sisu is one of those untranslatable words in another culture. So sisu is a word that in Finland, it's generally understood to be guts or determination. So that's like a Finnish thing. Like if you have sisu, you have guts. I've also read that it could be somewhat pathological, so I watch out for it because it's determination in the face of repeated failure is also part of the meaning of this word. So if you have sisu, you will just keep ramming at something, even if you fail at it, but you'll just keep on going because that's so, you know, I kind of watch out for that a little bit. But I also, since I'm a tattooed person.
Right, you are.
And my mom's side of the family is very, like, I'm close to that side of the family. So I had sisu tattooed on my arm with some folk art style art around it in order to just kind of remember, you know, where some of my roots are from.
Nice. Very nice. I have another question coming, but I'm going to tell a little story first. My daughter Diane, who lives in California, and her partner Amanda, they live out there. And Amanda grew up in northern Illinois, and she has a gift for languages for whatever reason. But she spent a whole year in high school, a school year in high school, studying in Finland with a family. And she tells the story the day she got there, The family greeted her at Helsinki Airport. They took her home. They had a nice big family meal. As soon as it was finished, they all went outside. They went to the sauna. They all took off their clothes. And Amanda said, okay. And she did the sauna. When we lived on the farm in Minnesota until I was six, the neighbor, Mr. Berg, there was a sauna outside of his house. Now, he never used it, but Mr. Bugemann, who lived there before, used that sauna. Well, Mr. Berg just used it for storing logs. And as a little kid, when they talked about the bath, I didn't comprehend. A bath? Where's the water? But I was 5 years old. How would I know? Right. Yes. And you with the sauna?
When I was in Finland, I worked there before the holiday Christmas markets. I had a friend and her husband, and they made beautiful tapered beeswax candles to sell at the Christmas market. So I went and worked for them for a month. And where they had their candle making factory, there were other artists and designers with studios in that building. And they had a sauna for the entire building. And so my friend, I was just too shy to get naked with a bunch of people that I didn't know. So I would wait until everybody else was done with their sauna for the day, and then I would go have mine.
You were the odd man out.
They were like, okay, she's an American. Not comfortable with her body.
Right, right.
Like Marilyn said, in northern Minnesota, all of the farms out there, my relatives, like, they all had a sauna in the outbuildings outside of the farm. It was just part of, like, family culture. It's like, as soon as you have your home built, you also have to have your sauna built, you know, so that you can take your bath. And when I see people's saunas here, they're usually beautiful, right? They've got cedar lining.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
They smell great. And my side of the family, it was just like whatever building works. You put a stove in it, and you get it hot, you put some rocks in it, and get steam going. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have to, it wasn't fancy. It was very much like, here we are, and here's our outbuilding, and this is where the sauna is going to be.
Thank you, Kristin. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's start. I'm turning the fire on. I have potatoes and onions and butter in here. We have the big pot of fish stew in the kitchen. And I have a piece of walleye. And I'm going to skin this. We start at the end. And of course, when you watch them on TV, all they have to do is hold on to it and you pull this off. That doesn't work with crap. You have to keep cutting it. And of course, into this fish stew, the recipe is potatoes, onions, fish, some seasoning, some slurry to make it thick, and milk. So it's a nice, white, gentle soup. And this is walleye, any kind of a white fish. And I know Kristin said, how about salmon? And I said, I don't think salmon. So she got the walleye, which is great. And do we have any you-know-what in there?
Yeah.
Yep. And I tried with tweezers, and I discovered that doesn't work very well. This is a boneless piece of fish. That's good. And cut up into some pieces. You can see how carefully you have to do this and measure it carefully. Put the fish in there. When I was cutting up the fish last night, and it took a while, and no odor whatsoever. So you know that is fresh walleye. You know, I can smell fish a little bit, but that was wonderful. And of course, if you have a cat, they would love this, wouldn't they? Our son and his wife and the two grandsons, their cat had died. They purchased a Maine Coon cat, Anybody know what that is? That they grow to be the size of a Cocker Spaniel, but it's a cat. But I understand it's a gentle, loving cat. Well, they ordered it and picked it up close to Chicago, and the cat, Leroy, had just come in November, probably the last, well, it was born in November, but came here when he was 4 months old to Chicago, the last plane out of Russia. He was, yeah, right, right. So they have Leroy, a nice, nice cat.
Did you say he's not a nice cat?
A very nice cat. And of course, they know enough to hold on to the tail and the paws and the whiskers as a kitten, so that the cat will be used to that. Last night they started with a harness, and of course, Leroy didn't much care for that, but they kept feeding him, and that was fine, because mainly he's interested in food right now. He's growing. And he's trained him to come with a clicker as a little kitten. That's great.
I thought Malcolm's didn't have tails.
A long one. Are you thinking of Manx?
I don't know. I guess I'm thinking of something else.
Okay. Yeah, he does have a nice long tail. I'm putting a little bit of flour into this and some boiled potato water. And you know, because you've all been cooking for a long time, you never use warm water when you're trying to get the gravy or the white sauce to thicken, right? Because you will have just lumps and nothing else. Now we'll turn this up a little bit. Next month, in April, we're doing bananas. So we'll do Flaming Bananas Foster on banana ice cream. And you don't find banana ice cream very often. It was my grandfather's favorite of all. But he was born in 1889. And the only fruit that ever came in the northern or in Minnesota were the bananas on the train. So in that part of Minnesota, banana ice cream was very common. So, and he loved bananas, especially bananas that were overripe and mushy. And he lived to be 102. And he drank lots of weak Scandinavian coffee. Half a cup of coffee with half a cup of cream. And we'll do the tostones, which is the plantain that looks like a banana. And we'll mash it and make little fried patties. And then we will make banana pancakes. Remember Faith Gruber? She's coming back to help. This is Faith Gruber's recipe. A mashed banana with an egg. And you make it into a pancake. That's it. Two ingredients. Oh my, that tastes great. Woo. I have another spoon. Kristin, you want to taste it?
Sure. I don't know if I can, if it's hot, if I can taste it as quickly as you can.
It's just a little bitty piece.
Oh.
Yes.
It is really good.
I know. I hope the big pot is that good. We'll add this to the big pot. Okay, let me pull this out. Let me disconnect. And so far, I have not tripped on the cord.
And the cord works this time.
Yes, and last time, they were telling me to check the outlet. No. Well, they were the kitchen staff was absolutely right, and I was absolutely wrong.
Hey.
Yes.
We should say that Finland is the happiest place on earth for 5 years in a row.
That's right.
Yes, and an extremely high standard of living, and I think the best education system in the world. And is it Finland or is it Sweden? No. Switzerland that pays their teachers the same as airline pilots and physicians. And funny how that works out so well, right?
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
Yes, what a surprise. The lady from the gift shop insisted that I have this sugar, for the Pulla bread. Well, Kristin didn't have it at home, so we're taking some out and we're just going to. And it sort of looks like pretend snow, but it's sugar.
Marilyn.
Yes.
I noticed that there is a difference between the Swedish, which you have in your hand, and the Belgian.
And the Belgian.
It is larger granules.
Oh, is it even bigger than this?
Yeah, right. I like this.
Well, there isn't much in this world that I don't like, I must tell you. And the lingonberries. And when you taste these, you will think that they're cranberries. I read some of the cookbooks of a Swedish, Finnish woman who lives in the United States, and she uses cranberries.
Oh, really?
And they do taste alike. Our open face sandwiches, it's that crispy cracker bread, because that's easy to make. And then I mixed together drained cottage cheese and cream cheese, just to make it not so wet, and it would spread better, because we're making these ahead of time. And then we have carrots and radishes and egg and parsley and green onion, all sorts of things on them. And when you see the pictures of these open face sandwiches in any of the Scandinavian countries, they put lots of toppings on it. Can you bring the fish stew, please? You're going to be impressed by the. We purposely put it into this pot instead of a Nesco, because this will be much more entertaining than a Nesco. Oh, in here I have onions, potatoes, butter, and then that slurry, and then fish. Look at that. Did you see Vicky's outfit? She put this together from St. Vincent. Yep. And then, you know, Ryan Sorensen is going to be doing a German cooking class for us, and that'll work for that one also. I'm sure in Finland and in Germany they could tell the difference, but we here in Sheboygan cannot. And you see, it is just white. White fish, white onions, white potatoes, and milk. And let's put this flavorful one in there also. I didn't think you needed to watch me peel potatoes or slice onions. I think you don't need to learn that. You already know that. Okay. Then we need some servers with gloves. Any questions? Wasn't a lot of making demo in front of you today, but there will be in bananas. And there will be, and I'm thinking, depending upon how the mayor decides to do his German cooking class. Okay. And I would say, you know, somebody can use a ladle of this, and the other person can use this half. That works great. And I think we'll start at this end. Bring your plate, and we'll have the open face sandwich, the soup, the pulla bread, the lingonberry, and the surprise caraway rye cookies.